So yeah, my name is Christian. I used to be a PhD student at ETH Zurich, working on Bitcoin, and since half a year I'm now working with Blockstream, or at Blockstream, on some of the topics I started with during my PhD. I'm sorry I can't hold this in French, but my school French is a bit rusty. I hope you don't mind. And you probably would not like my Swiss accent. Okay, so I guess everybody knows about Bitcoin. Who doesn't know about Bitcoin, please raise your hand. That's a bit unfair, we should have done it the other way around. Who does know Bitcoin, please raise your hands. So, as we all know, Bitcoin is a... I definitely don't have material for 2 hours. So there's lots of room for questions. If you have any questions, please interrupt me right now. The worst thing that can happen is that I tell you it's on the next slide. At which point I'll just defer you to the next slide. I think that's everything I have to say about administrative. Okay, so since everybody knows about Bitcoin, we all know Bitcoin is a currency. Bitcoin is a system, and Bitcoin is a protocol. And as a currency, we would like to use Bitcoin in every day to buy goods and services. And me, being growing up in the Italian-speaking part of Switzerland, I like coffee, and I guess every computer scientist can agree with that. And I would like to buy coffee with Bitcoin. Sadly, though, buying coffee with Bitcoin is rather cumbersome, as we will see now. So, nope. People like me? Sorry about that. Will it work now? Yes. Okay. So, that's me on the left. And my coffee is on the right. So what would we do if we were to buy coffee with Bitcoin? Well, I would create a transaction, spending some of the funds I own, being the green output, onto the barista, which is the blue owner. I'll symbolize outputs with the circles and transactions with the rectangles. And the color indicates who is the owner of these funds. So the effect of this transaction would be to take 5 of my Bitcoin, transfer 1 of them to the barista, and 4 back to me. That's what we could change. So that's a transaction I'd like to effect. I'll send that transaction onto the Bitcoin network. Every node in the Bitcoin network will receive this transaction, will verify that I actually own these funds, that I am allowed to spend them, and will apply them to their local view of the balances. And once the node has done that, he will forward that to the other nodes in the network who will do the same. And after a while, one of these nodes will find the block and will confirm the transaction. So there is some time involved in this. This expectation is 10 minutes after I send my transaction into the Bitcoin network. So by the time I actually get my coffee, it's cold. And I really hate cold coffee. Unless it's iced coffee, that's okay. So one of the downsides of the current Bitcoin system is definitely it's not the quickest. Another downside of the current Bitcoin system is it simply does not scale. There is no way that every single user in the world could buy his own coffee with a Bitcoin transaction just by creating a transaction, broadcasting it into the network, and having it confirmed. Here we see a few of the intrinsic limits that we have in the Bitcoin system. The first one is disk space. If we were to create 500 transactions every second over a year, then every user that runs a full node would have to buy a 10 terabyte disk every year just to store all this historical information. The next is processing. Once if a node receives a transaction, he has to go look up that these funds are still unspent, check that the signature is valid, and then apply it locally. That takes about 5 milliseconds for each transaction. Hence, we have a limit of about 200 transactions per second. Then we have a much more stringent limit, which is the network bandwidth. You see, in Bitcoin, the speed at which we communicate is critical for the security of the whole system. If we are communicating slowly in the network, then the local views of the individual nodes can diverge, and we can we get disagreements about who owns which funds and which transactions actually happened, and so on and so forth. And only then we have the most restrictive limit, which is this artificial 1 megabyte limit that Bitcoin Core currently imposes. And it turns out that this limit is consensus critical. We cannot change it without having old clients basically drop off the chain. So that the fact that these are limits are intrinsical to the network are shown basically below, where we can see that in order to reach 50% of the nodes in the network, we have a certain bandwidth which we can use, and that bandwidth flattens out incredibly quickly. So if we want to reach 50% of the network, we would have about 600 kilobits per second of bandwidth available. If we only want to have 5% of the network, is that the 90th? Only 10% of the network uninformed, we're around like 25 to 40 kilobits per second. So that's the actual throughput of the network itself. So transactions on the Bitcoin blockchain do not scale, but we'd still like to buy our coffee. Is there a way to sidestep this? Is there a way not to do all of these transactions on the Bitcoin blockchain, but still have the security of the Bitcoin blockchain? Well, it turns out that around 2011, a guy named Jeremy Spielman came up with an idea of a micropayment channel. And this is a smart contract between two endpoints in the Bitcoin system that allows us to have rapid incrementing transactions without having to go to the Bitcoin blockchain every time. So let's see how Jeremy did it. So here again, we have my 5 Bitcoins. And now I want to go to a barista and say, here's 0.1 Bitcoin, give me a coffee. Here's another 0.1 Bitcoin, give me another coffee. And here's another 10 Bitcoin and give me 1,000 coffees. So what I do is I basically go and take these funds and transfer them onto what we call a multi-sig address. A multi-sig address, we can imagine this as a shared account between the two endpoints of our channel. What this means is that if we want to spend these bitcoins that are on this multi-sig, both of us need to sign the transaction. And I'll have some small hints where transactions are later. So that means that once we have created this multi-sig output, then I cannot spend them unilaterally. He cannot spend them unilaterally. We have to agree on what we want to do with these funds. Okay. So what we do then is we take these 5 bitcoins on the multisig and send all of them back to me. Well, the eagle eyes among you will see that this doesn't do much. I mean, I take 5 bitcoins of mine and I get them back at the end. I created 2 transactions in between, but not much happened. The difference is that we go. Oh yeah, ice. So this is what I meant with the signatures. In this scheme, whenever I add a small colored rectangle, that's to the transaction, that means that the guy with that color signed. So I create this transaction spending these 5 bitcoins back to me and 0 to the barista. And I sign it. Now I can't do anything with that transaction because the blue signature is missing. What I can do is hand this transaction over to the barista, and now he has all the ingredients he needs to add his signature, making this transaction valid, and broadcasting it into the network, effectively committing this state of our channel. So now that we have this set up, I will broadcast the first transaction, getting it confirmed in the Bitcoin blockchain, which actually creates this multisig output. The second transaction is not yet going to the Bitcoin blockchain. The barista is basically holding it in his backhand and waiting for me to do more. Now in this case, I come along and I want to buy my first coffee. So what I do is I create a new transaction, now giving me back 4 bitcoins, and 1 bitcoin goes to the barista. So as you can see, now the barista is actually getting paid for for the coffee he's giving me. I'm signing this and I'm handing over the transaction, the half signed transaction, to the barista. And he now has the option of either taking the one which gives him 0 bitcoin, or he could take the transaction with the 1 bitcoin. Which one will he probably choose? The one which gives him 1. So, and notice that the previous transaction is not valid anymore because we are basically spending the same funds, right? If I have a $5 bill in my hand and I give it away with the second transaction, then I don't have it anymore for the first transaction. So what we have done is basically replace the old state, which was 5 to me, 0 to him, with a new state, 4 to me, 1 to him. And now we can go on. I'll buy another coffee. Now the new state is 3 bitcoins to me, 2 for the barista, and he actually has gotten his incremental payment. I again sign it, hand it over, and he can now choose which one to broadcast. We do that a couple more times, and I think this is the last one. Now, I'm basically going to the barista and say, hey, I'm jittery enough, I don't want any more coffee. Please commit this final state. So he will add his signature, making this transaction complete, broadcast it into the Bitcoin network, and actually committing this final state to the Bitcoin blockchain. And eventually this transaction will also be confirmed, and we have closed our channel. So what have we done here? We have had 2 transactions on the blockchain, one to set up the channel and one to close the channel. The closing channel actually commits the final state of the channel. And what happened in between? Nobody knows except us. We could have traded back and forth hundreds of millions of times, and all that ever touched the Bitcoin blockchain are these 2 transactions. So that's kind of nice. There is only one problem. Is there a way for the barista to send me money back? Anyone? Well, I said it was a downside, so no, there is no way. The problem is that if he were to give me money back, he would still have, so let's say he gives me back 1 Bitcoin and we go back to a state where I have 2 Bitcoins and he has 3 Bitcoins. He's still holding in his hand the transaction which enforces this 1 and 4 state. So he will always be incentivized to commit the transaction which gives him the most value. And hence we I call this replacement by incentive. Now I have 2 more schemes for layer 2 protocols or smart contracts or whatever we want to call them. And these are replaced by incentive, which we've just seen. So the party that is committing the transaction is incentivized to commit the last version because it gives him the most. Then we have replaced by time lock, which is a system we published 2 years ago called duplex market payment channels. I'll give a simplified version of that. Oh, and that should be threat, not thread. And the last one is replaced by threat. So that's a T, not a D. And the last one is actually lightning, which we'll come back to. Okay. So I might have botched this animation. Let's see. Okay, we start off with the same system. I have 5 bitcoins, I transfer them to a shared account, which actually locks in these 5 bitcoins into our contract. And then we create this this strange transaction in the end, which gives 5 to me and 0 to the barista. Now, what's this T equal 100 there? That's what in Bitcoin is called a time lock. So what this means is that only at day 100, this transaction becomes valid. So if one of the parties now disappears, then we would have to wait until T100 to reclaim our funds. And this is signed by both. I'm omitting the signature boxes because, well, they're always signed by both parties. Okay, so how do we replace funds here? That's pretty easy. If we have a transaction which becomes valid at day 100, can we maybe create a transaction that becomes valid at day 99 and then wait until day 99 and commit that? The old state can only be committed a day later, right? So we have a full day to actually commit this value and enforce this last state we agreed upon before any old value becomes available. So here again, I have transferred 1 to the barista. And this actually works also in reverse. So you see that I just transferred back 1 Bitcoin from the barista to me. This is valid because we don't replace by incentive anymore. If it were by incentive, then the barista would try to enforce the one where he gets 1 Bitcoin and not the one where he doesn't get anything. But since these have descending time locks, I can actually go at day 98 and publish this and get it confirmed before the old states ever become valid. And we can go on here, transferring back and forth a few times. And now, here's a problem. If we want to close the channel, now we would have to wait 96 days. That's not ideal. And if one of the parties disappears, then we would actually have to wait 96 days to get our money back. Luckily enough, if we are both online, we can just replace this with a transaction that does not have a time lock and get that published into the blockchain and commit this final state. And that's how duplex market payment channel works. There is one downside, which is, you probably have guessed it, there's a limit to the number of replacements we can do. We can only decrement this timer until we get to now. Once we get to now, then all future replacements are valid right now. And so we don't have this, the new state invalidates the old state anymore. They're all valid all the time. So what we did there is basically the old computer science trick that everybody knows. We made that into a tree, and that sort of gives us almost exponential number of increases with some other trade-offs. Okay, so that's replaced by time lock. And the last system I want to talk about is actually Lightning. Now, Lightning is a bit different, and it's also quite hard to draw, as Fabrice would probably tell everybody. So I divide. Oh, that's really hard to see, isn't it? Can anybody see that?
Yes.
Yep.
That's two colors.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think green is the upper half and blue is the lower part. Sorry about the colors. So what we have now is we have asymmetric information. There's information I hold and there's information which the barista holds. And depending on how we what state we want to replace, we disclose part of our information to the other side. So what does this entail? And I will not do replacements here because they're just messy to draw. So, both, yeah, the upper part is blue, hence secret blue, and the lower part is green, hence secret green. So both endpoints generate a random secret. That's just any big random number, probably in the range of 2 to the 256. And we do not tell it to anybody. Now, we create two transactions. These two transactions, one is for me, one is for the barista. And the effect they have is the same. However, they are slightly different in who owns the other side of the transaction. So, here I want to transfer 4 to myself and 1 to the barista. And on the barista's side, the transaction that closes the channel has a value to himself, which goes to him after T100, or to me if I can reveal his secret. So if he tells me his secret, I can steal his funds before these 100 days are over. And the same goes for the other side. If only on my output, and if I reveal my secret to him, he can steal my funds. Probably have mixed them up again. I always do mix them up. Okay, so what happens if we want to update our channel state? And for example, transfer only 3 to me and 2 to the barista. We create these transactions, sign them, and distribute them. And then we also need to invalidate the old state. I'm not showing the new state, I'm just showing the old state here. So what we do here is basically, I give the barista my secret, and the barista gives me his secret. Why isn't that showing? Oh, there it is. Okay. So what happens if I publish the old state here? Now, if I publish the old state, which is this one, then I have to wait 100 days, and only then can I get my funds, while the barista gets his Bitcoin immediately. But the barista does know the green secret. And so he can jump in and steal my funds. So now, instead of these transactions going part to him, part to me, they always go to the other party, which is not misbehaving by trying to publish an old state. I like to compare this basically to sitting in front of each other and agreeing on something. And once we have agreed on something, I hand the other party a shotgun with which he can shoot me if I ever try to misbehave. So that's in this case the replacement by threat, because if I misbehave, he can steal my funds. Okay, so I think those are the three systems I wanted to talk about. So Yeah, so these are three systems. One is only unilateral. The other two are duplex. So payments can go in both directions. Lightning is more complicated in my opinion, but it has infinite replacements. Whereas duplex is simpler, there's no asymmetry of information, but we have a limit on the number of replacements. In reality, this limit does not really come into play because the number of replacements, if you open a channel with one Bitcoin, you can transfer the US deficit back and forth four times before you need to close the channel. So, to everybody who the one who likes more. But we're implementing Lightning, so this seems to be the standard that that will win in the end. Okay, so these are the three systems, and now I'd like to talk to you about a bit about other features we are building on top of these simple channels. Well, not so simple in some cases. So it's of course nice if I can transfer back and forth between two endpoints. However, it's not much use if every time I go to a new merchant and I want to trade with him, I have to open a channel, which involves having a transaction confirmed, and only then being able to send back and forth. So we would like to skip this initial setup, and also if I just do one transfer to this merchant, then I'm still opening the channel and closing that channel just for one transaction. So that's highly inefficient. So what we would like to do is take a page out of the internet and see how the internet solves this. You see, if I want to contact a server via Facebook, I'm not taking a copper wire and drawing it from here to Cupertino and plugging it in on their server. And if I then want to contact Google, I'm not drawing another copper wire to somebody else. No, I have one copper wire which goes from me to my ISP. And the ISP will then forward any data packets I want to send to somebody else. And eventually, by going through multiple hubs, I will reach the server that I'm contacting. So wouldn't it be nice if we could have one persistent micropayment channel that allows us to transfer bitcoins to any user in the network without having to go to set up an extra channel every time I want to do a transfer. So this is exactly what we do. We have intermediate nodes, and our payment goes basically from us to another node, which forwards it to the next node and forwards it to the next node, and finally we arrive to the merchant that I'm interested in paying. So, is this secure if we just do it like this? I'm handing you €5 and I'm trusting you to hand it over, and you're handing it over to the next guy. Not really. I mean, there's always bad people who will say, okay, I forward this payment, but in reality they just took the money. So what we'd like to do is have a sort of end-to-end secure payment, meaning that I transfer money to the first hub transfers the money to the second hub, the second hub transfers to the fourth hub, and so on. And these transfers only happen if the money actually reaches our intended destination. So that means that we have to have some sort of atomicity across multiple channels. Now, how do we do that? So there's a thing called an HTLC, and the background colors will be bad again, but sorry about that. So this is an output which has this HTLC script attached to it. And this HTLC script basically says, who is the owner of these funds? And currently it's gray, meaning that we don't exactly know who these funds belong to. And on the right side we have the script. So if the upper part of this if branch, of the upper if branch is activated, then I will have to provide a secret that matches something that I specified before and my signature for it to be valid. So we can imagine this as me going to the barista. The barista says, okay, here's a hash of a random value that I've kept for myself. I'm giving you the hash, and if you can show me the secret that hashes to this value, then this transfer actually happens. Otherwise, and that's the lower part, otherwise I will wait for 6 hours, which is this 36 object sequence verify, and then I can get it myself. So this is a timeout condition. If nothing happens for 6 hours, the barista just, I get my money back. Okay, so what do we do here? I go to the barista, barista gives me the hash of the secret. I go to the first hop in my multi-hop payment, and I basically promise him, hey, here's a Bitcoin, and you can get it if you can show me the secret which hashes to this pre-image. The first hop doesn't know what the secret is. How could he? The barista has it. So what he does is he goes to the second hop and says, hey, here's a Bitcoin. If you can show me the secret, then it's yours. Otherwise, I get it back. The second hop goes to the third and says, hey, here's a Bitcoin. If you can give me the secret, it's yours. Otherwise, I get it back. And so on and so forth. Eventually, we will reach the barista, which has the secret. And he is promised, hey, if you can give me the secret, you get this Bitcoin. And the barista says, okay, here's the secret, give me the Bitcoin. But at the same time, the barista getting his Bitcoin reveals the secret to the previous hop, which allows him to get his Bitcoin. And so on and so forth, until eventually the first hop, which is the first one that I contacted, has had his Bitcoin retrieved. And now it's his turn to say, okay, I got the secret, I lost one Bitcoin, let me turn around. Here's the secret, give me my Bitcoin. And that's how we go from having a multi, from a single channel to multi-hop payments and having end-to-end secure payments. And the really nice part about this is that if the barista has signed an agreement that says, hey, if you have the secret, then I receive my payment, you now have the secret itself acts as a receipt for you that proves that you paid, and the barista can do nothing to retract that. So we have this atomic swap of payment and receipt. And we could probably also build a few nice schemes that actually exchange encryption keys with this scheme. And so we have atomic swap of information for a payment. Okay. I hope that wasn't too out in the woods there. Okay. So another nice feature about Lightning is a personal favorite of mine, because I implemented it, is onion routing. So we know in Bitcoin we publish a transaction and broadcast it worldwide, and everybody sees the transaction and everybody knows, hey, there's something that happened, which is terrible for privacy. Suddenly everybody knows that there has been a transfer, and with a bit of luck they can even create profiles. So Lightning is sort of in between there. Only the nodes that participated in forwarding this payment will know the endpoints, which is still kind of ugly. So what we did here is we learned a lesson from Tor, the onion router, and use an encryption technique that allows us to basically attach routing information to a payment in such a manner that only the node that is processing the current hop can read what happens. So what happens here is that our payment gets an encrypted blob attached. And if I'm one of the hops on the network, I receive an incoming payment from my write. I decrypt this blob, and I see, okay, my instructions is to forward it to this direction, and that's what I do. I hand the packet, the encrypted packet over, along with the payment, and all I learn is that the payment came from this previous hop, and it went forward to this next hop. I did not learn about who is the origin, what position I am in this whole multi-hop payment, and I did not learn the destination of the payment. All I learned is that there is someone who transferred something, and I know the value because that's what I transferred. But I don't know who, what, and to whom. On another level, so that's privacy on a multi-hop level. On the lower level, we are also encrypting the endpoint communication using the noise protocol, so even an eavesdropper on the wire cannot collect information and collude this information to reconstruct what actually happened in the network. And comparing that to how Bitcoin stores, how Bitcoin leaks privacy information in the classical on-chain payments, this is quite good because the individual payments here never ever touch the blockchain. We only commit aggregates of all transactions that happen in between to the blockchain, never individual transfers. So it's getting harder and harder to read what people did on the blockchain, and I think that's good. So let's see a few of the advantages. Probably should have stressed this more, but this is really, really good for scalability. We've seen how with two transactions, the channel open and the channel close, we can have any number of transfers back and forth between two endpoints. And we also know that we can have any number of transfers over multiple hops. So we also we get real-time transfers. We're no longer waiting for transactions to confirm. We don't have these 10 minutes of thumb twiddling between ordering the coffee and then getting a cold coffee. This system works as fast as you can communicate, which is basically the latency between the hops. So this here you can pay in a matter of milliseconds, not minutes. We should also mention that all of these transfers are final immediately. There is no second confirmation. There is just, once I have promised you that you can get this money, you will get it, because you have in your hand the way to enforce this agreement. There is no way for me to go back and double spend or anything like that. We have an improved privacy. We don't commit any individual transactions on the blockchain. We only commit aggregates of these transactions. And I dare anybody to extract the information of a single transfer out of the aggregate of millions and millions of transactions. Adding to that, the onion routing protocol, it gives us this additional privacy measure to hide destination and origin nicely. And finally, we have a way to quickly experiment. Now, I'm probably sure that most of you have heard about this whole block size debate, and that everybody is in an absolute stalemate on what to do next, and nobody knows the path forward or backward. The The nice part about the problem about the block size debate is that we all have to agree. It's a consensus system. We all have to agree on what the next rule is. We don't have to agree on what to do here. We can actually change this protocol in a matter of days, weeks. We don't have all the only parties who have to agree on protocol changes here are the two endpoints. We have lifted the system from a consensus layer where everybody has to agree to a layer where we can just communicate among us. It's not a huge effort to improve the protocol, for example. We can extinguish bugs in this protocol in a matter of hours, not months. There's still some consensus bugs in Bitcoin which we cannot fix because everybody had to retrieve them. Okay. So of course I'm working for Blockstream, and Lightning is often seen as a Blockstream-only project. It's definitely not. The original paper came from Joseph Kuhn and Tej Draya. So there is a community around this whole effort. There's me and Rusty Russell from Blockstream. There's Fabrice and Pierre-Marie Badiou, I guess, from Assang, working on Eclair, sorry. There's the Français Fédéral coming through. Actually, they are the only ones who have a real brand for their client, which I think is nice. Then there's Joseph and Rosebeef, or Laodu, his real name I can never pronounce, who have founded Lightning Labs. There's Tej Draya, who is now at MIT DCI, the Decentralized Currency Initiative. And Bitfury has a few engineers working on it as well. And this is a community effort, and everybody is collaborating on a single specification that is trying to be as interoperable as possible. It's a very active project, and there's lots of discussions around what features we would like in there, what could be improved, what should be improved. And so we're all working on this specification together, and we all have open source projects, so all of this is in the open. And if you're interested, please join. We're in dear need of good coders. Okay. So, since this is a seminar, I thought I might add some open problems. Maybe there is somebody who can address these problems, and I would love to discuss potential solutions. So the first problem is routing. I told you how we do multi-hop payments, but I didn't tell you how we compute which route to take. How do we select the hops from me to my intended recipient? There's different approaches. We are currently implementing a link state protocol, which basically means that every node in the network knows the entire topology of the network. Obviously doesn't scale, but it's really useful because it allows us to do onion routing, because we are encrypting for a specific hop what information you should get. So knowing which hop is going to decrypt this is quite useful there. Other proposals are distance vector protocols, BGP, for example, though they would not allow for onion routing, but they would allow for stuff like multipath routing or in-network retrials. If one of the links goes down, we can just, well, let's try to route around it automatically. The problem of network topology, we do not know what the final network topology will be. There's quite a lot of speculation that it might be a star, this centralized system on the left. With really, really big hubs that connect end users. I don't think that will be the case, because operating such a hub is really ineffective for your funds, and it will be expensive. There's decentralized systems, and my favorite one would be the sort of mesh there. And we are trying to create the incentives necessary to create such a network. And payment decoupling is an interesting one. I told you that multi-hop payments use a secret. Now I can collude information. If I see multiple of these hops, I can say, okay, this secret is the same as this secret, so these must be the part of the same payment. We have mechanisms around that, but they are currently not implemented. And the final one is SegWit activation. There is currently this segregated witnesses proposal, which is currently being voted on. The reason we need it is because we are chaining multiple transactions one after the other, and the way we are chaining them is by referencing them using the hash of the transaction. Only the hash is malleable. So that means that if I broadcast a transaction, somebody could pick it up from the network, change it slightly, re-inject it into the network, thus changing the hash, and suddenly the transactions I did attached to it are disconnected. So really bad things can happen there. There's probably ways to create Lightning without incurring these problems, but the protocols are hard enough as they are, and not having a malleability solution would be really tough. So we're not interested as much in this block size increase, we're more interested in the malleability fix. Okay, I think that's it, and I think we're doing good on time, so I will have a demo. So I probably should warn you, this is the first time I'm doing a live demo, and I can almost guarantee it's not going to work. So with that out of the way, let me see. Okay, so this is a small demo I hacked up yesterday in half an hour. So on the right side we have the coffee shop. So this is the business end of things. On the right hand side we have the coffee shop, and as usual coffee shops do have a huge selection and I never know what to get. And on the right hand side we have my network client. So this would eventually be my phone, and this would be the cashier. So what happens in the background? In the background, I have, let me see, there it is. So in the background, okay. So, this is my Lightning client. This is what is running on my phone basically. There is my user interface. We don't care about that. Then we have the network, because doing a transfer between me and the barista is quite useless. It's easy. So what I did is I created 5 Lightning nodes that are also running on this computer, all connected to one another. So we have the top one connected to the second one to the third one, and so on and so forth. And on the last side we have... Nope, that's... Okay. And on this side we have the coffee shop. Easy to spot because it's called python-coffee.py. Okay. So what I will do is I will buy... Let me see if I can see my mouse. Caffeole. That's perfect. Okay, so what we have here is we have an invoice number, an address, and the amount I have to pay. You'll notice that this is denominated in millisatoshi. We're actually working with a 1/1000th of a 10 to the minus 8 of a satoshi. So I don't know what the current value is, but that's... I'm probably getting off cheap. So the address is the address of the Lightning node of the barista. And the invoice I called it invoice number, but in reality, it's just the hash of the secret I'm trying to show, or that I will bind my atomic transfer to. So let me see. There's probably going to be a warning. Okay. I did that before, apparently. So let me see. Is that the invoice ID? Yeah. Damn it. Yeah, you can't see it, but there was a nice graph here that shows the individual hops, and it was like 7 hops or so. So let's do the payment. Payment is being processed, and the shop refreshes every 5 seconds. So it took a while for the shop to notice, but the payment was processed correctly and it arrived at the barista. So let me try to do that again with the... this time with the graphic here. Yeah, so I was hoping to see this. So what we see here is basically, this is me sending the payment. This is the first hop, second hop, third hop, fourth hop, fifth hop, and the bar is down here. But, so yeah, that seemed to have been working. And yeah, that's the... Yeah.
Yeah, the node IDs there, are they just compressed public keys or...?
Yes, they are compressed public keys. So you'll notice that these are 66 characters in hex, which is 33 unhexed, and yeah, that's the size of the public key.
And my other question was about SegWit activation. You said you needed it. What if there was a way to activate signature modifiers, like going to CDH normalize without SegWit? Would that be
CDH no input would probably work. I'm pretty sure it works because CDH came up with it. He knows his stuff. But it would be quite an interesting change to the whole stuff. Because since you'd have to teach old nodes how to recognize SIGHASH no input, they would probably not accept these transactions, and thus it becomes a hard fork, which we can do. More questions? Yes.
Are you active on the core slack? Are you active on the core Slack?
On the Bitcoin core Slack?
Yeah.
I think I'm idling.
Okay.
But I know the LND chat is being mirrored on IRC, where I'm actually following along.
Okay.
So, yeah, the Bitcoin core Slack is quite good, but IRC is still the go-to medium to contact people.
Okay.
Us being geeks, it's IRC. Yeah.
Is the code to run a node available on Twitter or something to work with?
The nodes are all available. I mentioned that there is the implementation by Lightning Labs, LND. There is the C Lightning, which is ours, and there is Eclair, which you have an expert here in Paris. So these are all open source projects. I probably should add some links there, but they're all on GitHub, and you can probably find them by just Googling. And the spec is also on GitHub, as if somebody didn't recognize
it. Are you running to test it on the testnet?
Oh, this is running on the testnet right now. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, not this one, because it's... I wasn't sure whether I would have internet, so I just spun up rec test here. But testnet is working perfectly. We did have some tests, and we do have an active system right now. I think we have like 3 nodes active. So if anybody is volunteering an additional node, please let me know, and I'll help you set it up.
You can do thousands of nodes, right? Testing.
Yeah, that's a problem. There is not much of an incentive to test it before it goes live. and we would like to have a lot of testing before we go live, because once it goes live, there is people's money relying on this. So please help test and save people's money.
What is the principle of the construction of such payment channel? I mean, by a recursive search of connected nodes, or how it works in a large network?
I think you're referring to the routing problem, right? How do we find a path from us to the next to our intended recipient? That's pretty much an open problem. We are currently simply synchronizing the whole network. So we tell every node in the network about every link in the network, so that it can actually do compute a path from yourself to the recipient on your own machine without having to reach out to anybody else. We would like to have something more scalable. Because synchronizing millions of links onto a mobile phone is just not going to work. 1 million is going to work, because that's about 100 megabytes of data. But let's say 50 million is probably outside of the reach of a mobile phone. So if there's people who have a good idea on what to do with routing, we'd love to hear it.
Let us suppose that you will use something like shortest path, or is it true or not?
Currently we use Bellman-Ford,
which is sending, in fact, which is closely connected to which is an extension of the shortest path algorithm, the Bellman-Ford one.
Yeah. So we started off by using Dijkstra. Then somebody came along and said, "Hey, we'd like to have negative fees." And negative fees just kill Dijkstra, because you're just looping around all the time. So Bellman-Ford takes care of that. I'm pretty sure we're not going to use negative fees, because let's be honest, I'm not transferring your money without getting a share of it.
So my question is, let us imagine a pretty stationary network, same nodes, same connections, and thousands of different micropayment channels. Is it a problem if all the payment channels have the same route?
If all micropayments
if everything passes by the same network route.
Yes. So the problem is that we have a limited capacity on each of these links. If we have one Bitcoin on one of these links, we cannot transfer two over that link. That's the first problem. Then we have a capacity exhaustion, which basically means that if I have a connection with you and I add one Bitcoin, and this one Bitcoin is owned by me, I can transfer 1,000 times, 1,000s, but the imbalance can never become more than one. So I have this exhaustion at some point that I cannot do any more transfers, despite this channel that is still being there. The current idea is to basically just route around it. But that also has the problem that we have now a min-cut problem. So if we have a network and on one side is a huge retailer, and on the other side is every single one of its customers, then all the payments go in one direction. And so these channels will eventually get exhausted, and we will have to destroy them or add more funds to them or somehow rebalance these channels. And the hope is that people will be smart and notice that there is an imbalance, create back channels that route back, and thus creating these cycles that allow us to rebalance the channels in this cycle.
Maybe a simple randomization of the routes can improve.
We are randomizing the routes. But I'm talking about, if your retailer is there and all your customers are there, there's no way to get from here to here without going from here, right?
Yeah.
But yes, we do randomize some parts of it. And we adapt to channels being exhausted and failing and all that. fun stuff that is distributed systems free.
So do you know people in Open Bazaar to do Ruby?
I'm actually not sure how Open Bazaar works.
It doesn't work very well, but that means that they. More questions?
Yeah, is there some kind of a business intelligence in the network that you envision? Like, I have I'm a hub and I have 1,000 bitcoins from 1,000 customers. How do I allocate those 1,000 bitcoins to more channels, outgoing channels now, to connect optimally to other hubs? Without business intelligence, I cannot do that. And if I don't have some kind of insight into the way people will spend that money, I can optimize my health.
So what? There is no way for you to inspect the network as a whole. However, you can see that there are channels that are being exhausted quickly. You know that parts of the network are being defunded. Parts of the network are really unstable. Or that there is an intermediate hub which is charging incredible amounts of fees, and so you as an individual can jump in and route around this high fee node, and you can put yourself in parallel to channels that are being exhausted, so that you are channels being exhausted is basically an indicator of a channel being well used. Or,
and you determine there is a dynamic that each time that channel gets exhausted very fast, you replace it by a channel with more funds.
Yes, because you're still getting...
You know, that will be rich. And did they have a question when you said that to give economic incentives to get the right topology of the network? What are you thinking about?
So,
how can this be done?
There are a few incentives which are intrinsic to the system itself. It's pretty obvious that if I am a huge hub and all I'm talking to is end users, then the funds that are on these channels to the end users can only be used whenever this end user does a transaction. So the utility I'm getting from these funds that are locked into the channel, it's pretty small, because how often will my end user do a transaction? How often will I be able to grab a fee from this interaction? If, however, I have a connection which opens up a whole subnet, then I suddenly can use use the funds on this channel for every single transfer from this subnet to another subnet I'm connected to. So the utility I'm getting from the funds that are locked into the channel is much, much greater. So this is a natural incentive that arises from how Lightning channels work, simply because I get fees for when these funds are used. If they don't get used, I don't make fees. There are other parts. For example, becoming a huge hub means that I would have to allocate all the funds that could potentially be sent over this channel. So if I'm connected to Carrefour, I remembered the name. If I'm connected to Carrefour, and Carrefour makes one big salary payment once a month, and the whole rest of the time it just receives funds, then this imbalance is incredibly high, right? I mean, how much will Carrefour make in a month before he pays back the salaries? That's millions of euros I have to put at disposal of this one channel, simply because the imbalance can become so large. So there, the aggregation of multiple channels can be used, and hopefully we will have some rebalancing by funds going both ways. We also want to make it trivial for clients to open multiple channels. We have mechanisms where you can bundle channels so that it is pretty normal for me to have like 5 open channels, each with 0.2 bitcoins, or with they have the same utility for me as a single channel with 1 bitcoin would have. Even better is that if I now have 5 channels, I'm not I just removed my single point of failure. I'm not relying anymore on my on the other endpoint of the channel to stay online and allowing me to operate, right? If one of my 5 channels goes down, so what? I'm still in control of 80% of my funds. And we have lots more there. Yep.
Will it exist some services for node to have other node to control the channel? Imagine there is one channel between A and B, so I ask to C to watch what's happening in the channel and broadcast transaction if one of A or B.
Oh yes. So yeah, that's one point that I didn't mention, but we are sort of reliant that this, basically in Lightning, if I hand the other end the shotgun, I need to make sure that I am shooting him if he misbehaves, and that means that I am online at that time. Now we can adjust these times however we want with different trade-offs. If we have longer timeouts, we potentially have our phones locked for a longer time. And if we decrease the timeouts, we need to react more quickly. But there are mechanisms where we can outsource the shooting of the misbehaving party in such a way that we don't reveal anything to the outsourcee. So, as you mentioned, we could have a channel between A and B, and we could have an untrusted third party, which we just feed some data, which is basically we hand over the shotguns. And the third party will then monitor the blockchain, and as soon as there is something that he recognizes, he pulls the trigger. So that we don't have to be online all the time. Which is particularly useful for mobile phones, because my mobile phone is continuously offline and does not have network.
So will it be in the protocol, or there will be some services?
So it's not in the first implementation of in the first version of the specification, simply because we have not figured out all the small details and the specification is complex as it is. But we are certainly looking into it, and Taj is the guy who is most knowledgeable about that, and he will give us the answer to this problem. But you can do it. You can do it right now if you have a trusted node, which you allow to monitor your activity. You can just forward anything that you have to him. The only thing we are still bike shedding is how do we hand this to somebody who we do not want him to learn about what we did on the channel. Which, I mean, if we continuously hand shotguns, then he knows that something is going to is happening. And the more information we give him, the more he will be able to deduce from it. And we want to minimize that. Cool.
Do you currently work on the smart contracts implementation?
Smart contracts is a broad term. Broadly speaking, Lightning is a smart contract. Yes.
It will be an extension of the existing Bitcoin-like smart contracts. They are turnkey complete, or something like the Ethereum's smart contracts.
This is working on Bitcoin right now.
Only on Bitcoin.
Yes, and we do not need Turing completeness whatsoever.
And you are not planning to implement something Turing complete in the future? What's your opinion about that? About theoretical plateness?
So I probably should have mentioned this. There is an initiative creating Lightning for Ethereum called Raiden. They of course have a bit easier standing because they can rely on contracts to actually do the replacements and enforcing the final state. But we don't need Turing completeness here, and there's a few theories that you don't actually need Turing completeness anywhere. So, at least in smart contracts, because all you do is verifying that the execution was correct, and you're not executing them yourself. You don't need to execute something if you just need to verify that it was processed by the correct way. So,
have you looked at the other payment protocols like TumbleBit, for instance?
So TumbleBit has a similar micropayment channel construction, and I think they're unidirectional though.
You can play Alice in Bob and Bob in Alice. It's
I mean it's quite easy
with bidirectionality.
Quite easy to create bidirectionality if you just create the problem is that if you have unidirectional channels, these get exhausted pretty quickly because doing a payment back is not going to replenish the other sub. Yes.
For the price of coffee in this case is 1,000, right? And actually you pay 1,005. That means the host they charge the fee, right?
Yes.
If we must to pass so many hops, is it a problem because they will charge a lot?
So these multi-hop payments will probably not be very long. I mean, you are probably related by less than six hops, probably everybody in the world. So we currently limit our routes to 20 hops, which should be sufficient to get from any person to any other person. So there is an upper limit on the road length. Every node is in charge of its own fees. So I could create a really expensive hop that charges a lot for me to forward payments. And there are some ideas of discouraging using a channel that is close to being exhausted by simply topping up the fees. There is an incentive for people to connect far apart clusters, right? If I see that there is Dafool here, and there is loads of customers here, and there is one connection going across, then this one connection is getting all the traffic. But I'm free to create my own connections connecting these two clusters. So there is an incentive for me to create alternative routes around high fee spots and potentially creating short routes between these clusters. So this is speculative, but my hope is that that we will get a very small network, a small diameter network, with hopefully very low fees on each individual hop, hopefully making it very usable. But I think we'll see what happens, and if this does not work out, then so be it.
Yeah, but you need to convince Carrefour to open a channel with you. And if you ask Carrefour to open a channel with this, you can say, well, you're nobody, I prefer to open a channel with a big bank.
Well, but then I create a channel to one off from Carrefour and...
But then you will have to create if Carrefour only wants to deal with big banks, you will in order to pay Carrefour, or you will have to pass through the big band.
So cup food will become unattractive for customers to go to because they charge the payments have to have a large fee attached.
Yeah, but there's a risk of centralization in that sense. That I mean, both parties need to agree to open a channel.
Sure.
Well, maybe big corporations prefer to you know.
Let big corporations play in their own backyard and we'll be the big network here.
So that depends what you want to pay for.
I heard the Colore Train will be implemented on the Lightning Network. We can use Colore Train on Lightning Network.
So there is a pull request on the specification. Talking about integration with Kulu, for example. I'm not an expert on colored coins,
no,
but it seems doable.
I just wondering if you have this big company like Carrefour and you use colored coin, you don't the limitation of the number of Bitcoin in the channel is not a big limitation anymore because we don't transfer Bitcoin, we transfer colored coin.
Well, there is still an upper limit on the value attached to those coins that you transfer, which is then reflected back to the color of the coin. There are other issues with colored coin in Lightning. One of them is, for example, that we do need fungibility in all of this, right? If I'm sending a multi-hop payment, the coins that you receive in the end are not the ones that I send. I am sending to my first hop and he will get my coins and you will get the coins from the penultimate hop. So if we were to implement colored coins on top of Lightning, which I hope we do eventually, we would need to have a contiguous subnetwork that also transfers the same color across. And so suddenly from a single flow we go to a what's it called? Multicolor flow, basically, which is much more complicated, and the likeliness of having a contiguous network that allows us to transfer a color that is basically Ferrari or something like that's gonna be a tough sell.
It's not micropayments.
Yeah, true. Well, depending on the appreciation of Bitcoin, we might have micropayments in the size of Ferraris. Yes?
And when you begin this kind of transaction, so you know, before you begin, you know the price of your coffee, which is $1. But you don't know actually how many hops you will have during this transaction, and then you don't know in the end how much you should pay for the charge of the hops.
So that is true in the distance vector routing case, where we just send out a payment and let the network handle it. In the case of link state protocols, where we dictate at the beginning which path it should take, which is also a mechanism we use for onion routing, because we encrypt for the specific hops. In that case, we know exactly which hops we will use. In fact, we even know which channels we will be using from one hop to the next. So in that case, we know exactly what fees to attach. Downside, of course, being that we need to push this information to the endpoint, which needs it to compute the path. Yes?
Fees can change.
Yes. Fees can change. So what we do in the network is we have a gossip protocol where we tell each other what channels we know about and which nodes we know about. And there is a channel update message which also includes fees. And the fee is made up of two parts. One part is fixed, because there is a fixed amount of work I have to do for every transfer. and the proportional part, which is proportional to the amount being transferred. So hopefully that will cover most of these cases. Indeed, we also have, in this gossip protocol, we have an alias for the name and the color. If we were ever to draw a map with all the nodes on it, we could color them. And you could specify what color your own node would be. That's a bit of a joke there. Yes?
Where does the number of nodes grows like big? Is it still scalable? Is it like still cheap as a transaction?
So the transactions themselves will remain cheap. Hopefully we will be able to have short routes from one endpoint to any other endpoint in the network. What becomes expensive is the storage of the actual topology information, what channels exist, which nodes are in the network. And since we currently push all this information to the edge of the network, namely on your smartphone, if you're doing a transfer on your smartphone, that might not be desirable for huge networks. I mentioned before that for 100 megabytes, you have, for 1 million nodes, you can have, you have about 100 megabytes of data. Now scale that up to 1 billion, and you're definitely not going to store that on your phone. That's one of the open problems which we try to solve currently. This is, how do we create a mechanism that is scalable and quick to determine these routes and not pushing all this information to the edges. So it's an open problem.
That's why you control the number of nodes.
So we don't have any control over the number of nodes in the network, which is what makes up this huge amount of information. What we control is the length of the path. And the hope there is that by having 20, it's long enough.
Yeah. You said you have to set up the rule before you send the payment. What happens if the node turn off while you send your payment?
If your node turns off while you send your payment, so it depends on which stage you turn it off. So if I, let's say I'm the node that is about to turn off and you're my first hop, then I promise to you that you get your coins if you can show me the secret. And now I turn off, you'll still get your coins. And I will recover the secret from the stuff that is on the blockchain. So what happens in this case is we take the last state of the channel, which also includes the HTLC, which is the part where I'm asking you to give me the secret. Now this ends up in the blockchain, and you have to go on the blockchain and reveal that secret, which automatically gives me the secret next time I turn on.
If you turn back.
If I turn back on, then I get my funds. If I die completely, I lost my funds. Right. But that's the same thing. If you now take the axe to your computer, your data is lost. So. Yeah.
But you have to rely on other people.
Well, they can. It's in their interest to pull the money from you, right? And me handing you over the information to enforce this last state basically gives you the right to pull the money from me. And by pulling it from me, you reveal the secret to me, and I can pull it from my predecessor, or if I'm the origin of the payment, then I pay. If I kill myself before giving you the promise, then nothing happens. Hopefully not that soon. Come on, I know there's more.
What's your opinion, please, about the direct secret graph of cryptocurrencies, and do you think that they can compete seriously with the coin? Especially for payment, not only for micropayments.
What was the first part? Direct acyclic graph?
Cryptocurrencies. For instance, IOTA or Whiteboard or something like that.
I'm not familiar with those. Maybe you can tell me later about them.
But there are just cryptocurrencies, don't use blocks, but just direct.
You mean the braiding stuff? They work. I mean the whole idea of having tree chains or branded blockchains or whatever is not to waste blocks that were orphaned by somebody else. So what happens here is basically that I create a block and you create a block at the same time. Now one of us is going to win and his block is going to end up in the blockchain. Now the next one, creator of a block basically decides which one of our blocks ends up being the one that is in the blockchain. And braiding and tree chains basically do the following. They say, okay, this is the block I'm building upon, but I'd also like to recover some of the transactions in that one. So it's basically called an uncle, I think. So what you do is you strike out conflicts between those two blocks. If there are transactions which are conflicting in the uncle that are not in the parent, that are conflicting with something in the parent, then these get dropped. But I still gain the ability to confirm transactions that are in the uncle which are not conflicting. So there is nothing that changes the semantics of Lightning. In all of these cases, the only thing we rely on is the fact that we can get our transactions confirmed at some point, and whether that's in an uncle or a parent, that really doesn't matter. We only rely on confirmations. No one else?
A question about how will be the geometry of this Lightning network, but already for the Bitcoin network, what information do we have about the geometry? I mean, the average number of connections, the average number of cycles.
We don't have much information about the topology of the network itself, because we Bitcoin Core are working really hard at hiding it. The reason for that is that if we were to know how the network topology in Bitcoin looks like, then we would be able to isolate nodes from the rest of the network and become the only source of information about what happened in the blockchain, right? If I surround you with 10 of my copies, then I am the only one who tells you, hey, by the way, this transaction happened. And what happens in
of official client connects is not supposed to happen, right? This type of isolation. When you start your program and it starts to connect to other views,
yeah,
it is more or less random.
They are random, and I know that because I'm the operator of one of the DNSCs. And we have very strict policies about how we may select nodes that we propose to you if you ask us for bootstrap nodes. And we actually do return random nodes. Now, you yourself, if you run a Bitcoin client, you have an address pool from which you randomly select. So it should be as hard as possible for an attacker to basically take all 8 of your outgoing connection slots.
What is the average length path between 2 ports in the network? Do we know that? I'm thinking that probably the Lightning network would be similar.
They're random, and I'm pretty sure we can apply some Adeshvini expected diameter formula. So, depending on how close we are to a real random network, those might be more or less realistic. There's no way for us to verify that. Now, there were a few bugs a while ago which one of my master students found in the address pool which allowed you to detect to which other nodes you are connected, but that got fixed a while ago.
With the timestamps of the blocks, you cannot get a good idea of
how well connected are the original view?
The timestamps of the blocks are really, really messed up. The problem is that some pools at some point started rolling the timestamp as an additional randomness to create to increase the range of values they can push to their miners to find a valid block. And if you look on the blockchain, there are blocks which have an earlier timestamp than their parent. Which should not be possible.
Well, the thing is that if you have different nodes in different places, you can just compare your block when you receive a block, right?
Oh yeah, I'm doing that.
And from this, you can infer a little bit of the geometry.
Yes. So what we do have is, maybe I can show you. I am doing these measurements on. Or I cannot show you. Sorry about that. But yes, I am doing measurements in the Bitcoin network. I am tracing who sees what transaction at what time, and I do trace who sees what blocks at what time, and I am publishing aggregates of this information to basically say, hey, we have such and such an increase in efficiency of the network, and the reason why I'm doing that is basically I started off my PhD by basically showing that Bitcoin as it is built today is not scalable at all, and the blockchain fork rate is proportional to the block size, and yeah. So, but yes, people can do that. The information they get from it is not as clear-cut as one might believe, because there is a mechanism called trickling, which means that if I receive a transaction, I will select one connection to which to forward to immediately, and then wait a random amount of time, and then forward to the next one, and then forward to the next one, and then forward to the next one. And the reasoning is exactly to reduce the information I can get from correlation between the times I see these. So if I'm in the first, if I'm lucky and I am the first one to receive the transaction from you, then I will have a. Then I get it early, and if I'm unlucky and I am in the eighth slot, then I will get it. Then I will get it last, and there will be some time jittering between there, which is there to throw me off. So
this is done on purpose. Just to
this is done on purpose. Yeah. Exactly to reduce the chances of these topology and Furlow attacks. That's also why I publish aggregate information and not individual information on transactions. Yes.
Is there any security issue about using different Lightning? Clients to route a payment?
If there is a security problem?
Yeah.
Hopefully not. So we are working really hard to have a specification that we all agree on, and if we all do our jobs well and we all adhere to this specification, then there should be no problem security-wise. And we should be able to interoperate easily. As things are going right now, the Lightning developer community is really open, and we talk a lot, and we discuss a lot about the trade-offs, and I'm really hopeful about this becoming a project that really comes together in the end, and where we all are able to contribute and all are will build one big contiguous network instead of everybody's building small islands and not being able to interoperate. Because value comes from size, right? Cool. Yes.
Yeah, if a Lightning node advertises a certain amount of fees, like 5, applies 10 on, is there a penalty for that?
Well, the payment must be hail, and you are likely to not use the next time. So either you apply the fees you announce you will, at which point the attached fees will suffice for the whole route, or you charge more than what you advertised, and then the payment will probably stop, well, it will stop before reaching the intended destination. There is a bit of slack in there, because we have this gossiping protocol which propagates the fee updates. So if we increase the fees, we might be happy to accept the old fees for about a minute or so until this update has propagated far enough. Because if the payment has started before they knew that a higher fee was expected, then we should still accept the old fee. That being said, every node gets told exactly how much he has to forward. So we have a very explicit value how much fees you are allowed to deduct for this payment to still work. So this slack is really explicit in there. Yep.
No, just a question. What could be done if for some reasons Segwit is never activated?
Wait, I'll take a second. The dramatic pause. So there's alternative proposals to Segwit. I myself wrote one, which is called normalized transaction IDs, out of which Segwit basically grew in the end. We can probably work around malleability even if it is not getting fixed at all. Problem is that the protocol would get a lot uglier and a lot harder to implement. And believe me, Lightning is hard to implement as it is. So we would like Segwit, please.
So we really need to fix this malleability?
Oh, it's malleability is a really, really, really ugly bug. I don't know if anybody remembers a small exchange called Mt. Gox. They blamed the whole of their losses on malleability, saying that basically, hey, we sent a withdrawal, then somebody picked the withdrawal transaction out of the network, malleated it, reinjected it, and suddenly we didn't recognize our own withdrawal transactions anymore. Now, that's first of all not a smart thing to do, watching only for transaction IDs. And the second thing that didn't happen, basically, the 2 weeks after the Mt. Gox bankruptcy started, I published a paper showing that there is no indication of a malleability attack at that scale anywhere around that time. That being said, malleability is still a huge problem, especially for smart contracts. Whenever we have two transactions that follow each other, so the second transaction references the first one, and the first one is not immediately broadcast before we create the second one, or is not confirmed before we create the second one, then we always have the risk that that the second one is getting detached from the first one as soon as we broadcast them. And that really limits what we can do with smart contracts. Now, duplex micropayment channels and Lightning are examples of smart contracts. But as I said, these systems allow us to quickly innovate on top of Bitcoin without having to come to an agreement everybody together. It allows unilateral, permissionless innovation. And the more flexibility we give to system designers about what they can use and what assurances they can rely on to design their system, the more and nicer systems we will get in the end. If we keep malleability around, that strictly limits what we can do with smart contracts. And yes, Lightning can be done with, can probably be done without without SegWit or without a malleability fix, but it's going to be really ugly.
And what is the source of the problem? Does it come from ECDSA itself?
So ECDSA is part of the problem. So probably should introduce what malleability is. So if we create a transaction, then we reference the funds that we are going to spend by having an input. The input is nothing else than a transaction ID and output index tuple. The transaction ID is nothing else than the hash of the transaction that gave us these funds. It's like, hey, I'd like to spend the funds that I received back there. Now, if we have, in the event of a malleation attack, this transaction is being changed slightly before it gets confirmed. And so the second one is now pointing to into void. It's not pointing to a valid transaction anymore that is being has been confirmed, but it's pointing to something that simply did not happen. Now, how do we malleate transactions? The signatures in a transaction guarantee the integrity of the transaction itself. Except for the signature itself. There is no way for us to sign the signature in that same signature. So what we can do is, for example, we can use non-canonical forms of this transaction. It turns out that in ECDSA, the signature is a point on an elliptic curve. If we invert the y-coordinate of that point, we still have a valid signature. This is trivial to do, but the serialization looks different. So when we now hash this transaction, the hash will have changed. The output is actually the signature is specified in an input script. This input script is basically just up push and then signature. Now there's three different kinds of up push. There's a 1 byte up push, there's a 2 byte up push, and there's a 4 byte up push. It's pretty clear that we can have so the 1 byte up push can push something with a length of up to 255. The 2 byte push can push something up to 16,000 and the 4 byte push can push 4 gigabytes. Whoever thought of that, I don't know. But it's clear that I can simulate a single byte up push with a 2 byte up push. It's akin to having a number and just prefixing zeros.
This is just finite malleability. It's a finite modification you can do. I mean, that's fine, right? You won't get a finite number of hashes, but what we described.
Yes, but those are all aliases that we have to keep track of, right?
Yeah, but is this an infinite number of malleable possibilities or not?
So I'm not sure about.
If there's just a finite number, you have a finite list for each one.
So it's definitely finite because the length of the scripts is limited. The much bigger problem is that there might be malleability in the ECDSA algorithm itself. Like, for example, the fact that we can just mirror the...
Just one thing.
Yeah, but that's the one we know about. There might be others, which we don't know about.
Well, I guess there are only...
It is finite, but...
But the meaning is that if a transaction has 16 possibilities of signature, it's not a big deal, because
It is a big deal.
You replace the signature by the 16, right?
I had so my normalized transaction ID proposal was to introduce a single alias, and that was rejected because it would end up creating an overhead of 100 megabyte in memory on every node. So a single, it basically the number of aliases gets multiplied by the number of outputs in the unspent transaction output set. And the unspent transaction output set is getting bigger. So anything we any kind of information we add there, that's kind of tough. Did I really end up speaking for 2 hours?
Wow.
Did not think that would happen.
Well, thank you very much.